Today we're going to talk about faithfulness, and one of the things that I want to start with is a bit of a different story. Now, he's a hero of faith. He's Moses, and he's being asked to be faithful in something, doing something that God has called him to do, and he's protesting. And he's saying, but what if they don't believe me? And God looks at Moses, and he says, what is it that you have in your hand? And Moses, in Exodus 4:2, the Lord says to Moses, what is in your hand? And Moses says, a staff. I have a stick. And basically, God says, I can work with that. You and a stick. That let's free these people, right? So today, as we go through the message, I want you to be thinking, what is in my hand? And it doesn't have to be much. It can be a stick. It can be whatever. We're going to talk about relationships. We're going to talk about stuff. We're going to talk about just that prompting of the Holy Spirit and what you're doing with that. But don't discount what you have in your hand, even if it's not much. So I want you to think about that. The faithfulness is not about a what. It is not about the stick. It's about who empowers you. Who empowers you to be faithful? So it is about God. And I struggle preaching a message on faithfulness because I know myself and I'm not intrinsically faithful. Inside myself, if you boil it all the way down, I am not the faithful one. He is, right? I have at times forgotten my first love. I have lost the plot. I have forgotten why we do this or what we're building. I've thought about myself and gotten distracted. He has not. And I think it's interesting when you think about a call that God's put on your life. That's his call he's putting on your life, and he remembers it, and he doesn't forget it. And I know that gifting is something, but you know what? Anointing for a task is the power of God on your life, and anointing doesn't lift. Whether you're walking in it or not, that hand of the Lord is on you for that thing. So what is in your hand? 1 Timothy 2:13 tells us that we're not the faithful one. It says, and Paul's saying to Timothy, if we are unfaithful, if, you don't have to be unfaithful, you can walk faithfully. That's the encouragement here in this message. You can walk faithfully. He remains faithful, for he cannot deny who he is. And when we're talking about faithfulness, it is a fruit of the Spirit. And fruits of the Spirit are not things that can be faked over time. They only come from him, but they come through us as we remain in him. So they're not from you. We get a list of things, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, the whole list is not from us. It's from him. So faithfulness is on this list, and that means it doesn't come from me, it comes from him, and it means that I am just the vine, the conduit. The vine is not the root, the vine is not the fruit, the vine just exists by remaining in the branch, in the main part of the vine. What? A vine is a vine, I guess, but I'm confused now where that metaphor was going. The fruit is his. All right. So God is faithful. Jesus came. He spoke about faithfulness. He modeled it for us. And throughout Scripture, we see basically three different ways that people are faithful. There's the faithful friend. There's people that are faithful in relationships, you know, the faithful friend. There's the faithful steward. And there's the faithful follower. We see these all the way through Scripture. We're going to start with the faithful friend, and in Proverbs 18:24, it says, there is a friend that sticks closer than a brother. I always thought that was kind of funny, a friend that sticks. They don't just fall off. These are people that begin a relationship with eternity in mind. They're not investing in the here and now. They're investing in eternity, and you're the one standing in front of them. See, as Christians, it's not about being influential. It's not about being happy. It's not about dying with the most money or the most stuff and the guy who gets ahead wins. Success is defined by a word when it comes to God. And that's Matthew 25:23. The master says, well done, my good and faithful servant. Isn't it great that he defines us by something he does? Oh, you were faithful. You aren't accidentally faithful to people. You don't just accidentally walk closely with someone over time. It's one decision, one day at a time, over and over and over. It means commitment now with the end in mind. And we all have evidence of this, or have seen it, or seen the lack of it, so we know what it is. For instance, in my marriage, 18 years ago, I set a vow, and today I'm living in light of that vow. I'm not trying to get back to my first love and whatever those butterflies were. I'm not trying to get back to there. I'm in it to see the fruit that's at the end. I'm in it to see it all the way through. And the fruit isn't at the beginning. That's when the celebration is. The fruit is in the journey, the whole way along, to see it out. It's a choice to love. It's a choice to show up with consistency. It's a choice to invest. And when we're talking about the faithful friend, I want to just think about it in terms of investment. Friendship in the kingdom is not day trading. Okay? It's not about peddling influence. It's not about give and take, and I give and you take, or I did this for you, so you owe me. It's not transactional. Some of you that are in financial peace know that we don't necessarily recommend day trading as a general practice way of life. You invest for the long term. If you have the end in mind, and for financial terms, that's retirement, but in the longer term, when we're talking about relationships, it's eternity, right? You're invested for the long haul. You're making small investments now and consistently over time to reap a harvest at the end. Okay, I lost anybody who's not investing, so. The point is, show up, right? Show up for people. That's what a friend who sticks closer than a brother does. We've had people show up for us, and I think for some of us, the lesson might be, let someone show up for you. Yeah. All right? Sometimes we're a little too proud, and we kind of went through that. With our first child, we didn't know what to expect, and we were going through a lot of things. Jess dealt with a lot after the birth of our first daughter, and then the dryer broke, and she wasn't doing so well keeping up with everything as it was. I was working like crazy. The wheels were basically coming off. We had a friend who said, I'm coming over. And of course, we're embarrassed. Our house is a wreck. And this friend just showed up. She washed all of our clothes. She laid them out to dry all over the house. And she didn't mind the mess. She just came and she showed up. That's an investment, but it makes a lasting difference. That was 15 years ago, and I'm still blown away by it. Is there a relationship that the Lord has given you to invest in? Not what you hope that relationship would be, or somebody over the horizon, but who is in front of you? What is in your hand? Will they find you faithful? Will you be the one that they said showed up for me? So in Habakkuk, my favorite Bible name, Habakkuk 2:4, there's a verse that says, look at the proud. They trust in themselves and their lives are crooked. But the righteous will live by their faithfulness to God. That's how we're called to live. We're called to live faithful lives. That's how our lives are sustained, and that's how our way stays straight. It's not crooked. It's not bent in every direction, day trading and relationships. We're walking it out with the end in mind. So Jesus gives a good example of what that means to invest for the long term. He talks about it in terms of the talents. But when you're talking about the story of the talents, it's actually a story of the kingdom. So you want to think about it in terms of temporary stuff being traded for eternal significance, eternal wealth. And I do think that's one thing that the church and the body of Christ gives us a chance to do, and that is to take something temporary, whether it's time that we can't get back, money that we're not going to keep, you know, whatever it is, trading something temporary for something eternal. We have that choice every day. You can trade whatever you have that's temporary for something eternal. And that's Jesus. He's the only one that can do it. So in the parable of the talents, there's a master that goes on a long journey. And he looks at his servants and he knows their giftedness. And so he gives them his wealth in accordance with their giftedness and says, I'm going to be gone. I'll be back. So the master goes away on a long journey and he comes back and the different servants have done different things with the money. And some of them have doubled it. Most of them have doubled it because they were who he thought they were. And then there was one who took his one little talent that he was given and buried it in the sand and brought that. But we start with the ones that were successful. Matthew 25:21. To them, the master was full of praise. He said, well done, my good and faithful servant. You've been faithful in handling this small amount, so now I will give you many more responsibilities. Let's celebrate together. So one of your most faithful acts is to care for what God has placed in your hand, to invest it over time. If you're a steward of something, it means taking what you have and caring for it, maintaining it, and making more of it over time. Some of you are already doing that in business, and I think we shouldn't minimize that. That is a good thing to do. Being faithful in your work is a good way to remain faithful. It's a way to care for the stuff that God has given you. Faithfulness over time. I would like to get rid of this idea. One of the most impactful sermons that I've ever heard was a sermon about co-laboring with God by Paul Manring. He gave a message called Co-Laboring with God, and it was all about tearing down the secular sacred divide in our lives so that what I give here matters and what I do out there doesn't. We've got to get rid of that idea. If we're going to be good stewards, we got to realize that we're working for the Lord, we're not working for men. We're being faithful at our job because we're faithful to God, right? So if we are co-laboring with God, he goes with us to work. He cares about our work. He cares about how you invest the kingdom assets that he's given you. And as a business owner, a small business owner, a worker, you have the opportunity to bless the people under you, around you, and affect the atmosphere wherever you go outside these doors. And I'm a manager of a very small team, but how those guys experience work is within my direct sphere of influence. I co-labor with God to help them and be faithful to them in their job, right? I can make work a great place to be by being faithful to God. Isn't that a way of blessing someone else? Trading what is temporary for something that can make an eternal difference? See, sometimes we think that Jesus is just going to show up at our job, but he's showing up every day in us, if you'll let him. Co-labor with God, whatever he's placed in your hand. Churches need to be good stewards too. We can lead the way in generosity. Churches aren't meant to hoard what we have. We invest it back. Being a good steward as a body of Christ doesn't mean hoarding what we have. It means being generous and modeling that. So we intend to do that as a body. That is one of our core values here at Wooster Nazarene is generosity. Truth, worship, prayer, kindness, generosity. There you go, Andrew. I was paying attention in basics. I do remember this stuff. But there's one other part of the story. There is the servant who buried one talent. He was given the least, and he decided to do nothing with it. And Matthew 25 tells us, he says to his master, I was afraid, and I went out and hid your talent in the ground. See, here is what belongs to you. His master replied, you wicked and lazy servant. I can speak for all of us and say, I do not enjoy being called wicked or lazy. That would not be something that we're looking forward to. I think it's interesting, though, God is not hard on those that are truly afraid. He shows up and he says, "Fear not." He stands on the waters and they think he's a ghost and he says, "Come to me. I want to be with you." To the truly fearful, the Lord removes fear because perfect love drives out fear, right? So when he stands there and says, "You wicked and lazy servant," he's looking at the heart. This guy was not afraid. That was his excuse. "I was scared. I didn't know what to do. So I was not faithful. You gave me something to do, and I thought it would be weird. I thought it would be awkward. I didn't know what to do. It wasn't very much. It didn't matter anyway. And so I didn't." Wicked and lazy. Your heart wasn't in the right place. You didn't follow your master. You didn't really know who he was or why he put that thing in your hand. And you claimed you were scared. Hopefully, I'm not talking to you today, but that is talking to myself at some points in my life. I know that God has told me to do something, and just didn't wanna. I want to be found faithful. So to be faithful this way to each other, and to be faithful with our stuff, we have to be a faithful follower. We have to know our master. We have to know who he is and how he would do things. We need to trust in God to lead us, because while the wicked have crooked paths, who's the only one with the perspective that can chart out a straight course? It's not me. I see this, and sometimes not much more than that. He sees the end from the beginning. He's the one that can lead you down a path of faithfulness. Paul says it in Acts 20. He says, he shows how his Holy Spirit starts to show us what to do. He says, "And now I'm compelled by the Spirit. I am going to Jerusalem. I don't know what will happen to me there." He doesn't see the future. "I only know that in every city, the Holy Spirit warns me that prison and hardships are facing me. However, I consider my life worth nothing to me. My only aim is to finish the race and complete the task that the Lord Jesus has given me, the task of testifying the good news of God's grace." So God prompts usually don't mean much to us in the moment. When God shows up and speaks a thing, like there for Paul, all he told him was, "You're going to Jerusalem." And he's like, "All right, I don't know what's ahead. It seems a little scary, but I'm going." Sometimes the Holy Spirit is more specific. You heard there that Paul was compelled to go to Jerusalem. But often these God prompts that we're asked to follow, the way we follow our leader, is he gives us something seemingly small, but very specific to do. And you say, "Well, how do you know that? Where's that?" It's in the story of Ananias. When Paul was called, he was struck blind, and he ended up in a house, and he was praying to God to see, or whatever he was praying to God. He was in a desperate state. But God is specific. Acts 9, 10 to 12. God shows up and he talks to Ananias. It says, "In Damascus, there was a disciple named Ananias, and the Lord called to him in a vision, 'Ananias,' the Lord said his name. 'Yes, Lord,' he answered. The Lord told him, 'Go to the house of Judas,'" the house owner, "'on Straight Street.'" The Bible includes the name of the road. "'And ask for a man from Tarsus,'" where Paul was from, "'named Saul.'" He was named Saul at the time, not Paul. This is about to change. "'For he is praying. In a vision, he has seen a man named Ananias come and place his hands on him to restore his sight.'" This could not be more specific. Ananias had no choice in the matter except going to Straight Street and looking for a man who's praying, who is from Tarsus. Like, his obedience was a yes, no. You won't know the outcome from the beginning, but you'll probably know what you should do. And you'll probably know what you should do with that staff in your hand. God is faithful. He is faithful to tell us what it is we're to do with what's in our hand. And you might not know the outcome, and the journey might be a lot longer than you think. Then it might be more scary than you thought when you started. But most of us wouldn't have started if he would have told us the middle and the end from the beginning, right? So sometimes being faithful in a really small thing without knowing the end makes a big, big difference. I'm going to tell you a story, and it's one of my last stories, but believe it or not, 25 years ago, I was a 14-year-old boy that enjoyed just taking some things to the limit that I probably wouldn't anymore. But I had a this story is in two parts, so you'll get my mom's perspective in a second. But I had a grandfather who kind of believed in free-range parenting or grandparenting, and it was his land, it was his property, and I was with him for the weekend, so I had his four-wheeler, and it was a Polaris 500, and it went fast. So I took it all the way down to the reservoir where we like to go, and I was coming back, and it started raining, and I was wearing glasses, and I was like, if I go faster, I won't get as wet, right? Like, I'm going to get home before, you can see where this is going. There was a gravel road. I was 14, so I didn't know how to drive a car yet, and I'd practiced, like, skidding around the turns. I thought it was great, but I didn't really know the road all that well, and I came around a turn. I remembered looking down and being like, wow, this thing goes 50 miles an hour. This is great. I skidded straight through that turn. I hit a bank, and the mark on the tree was this high. I didn't fly off, but I did bust up the four-wheeler. And I limped it back to Grandpa, and to this day, I don't know if I pushed it all the way back or if I got it started or how I got home, but I was panicked because I didn't have money to pay for this, and this was all very bad. Grandpa was understanding, but I'll tell you from my mom's perspective, she was at home, it was Saturday, and all of a sudden she's walking through the house, and she just got this overwhelming feeling that she needs to pray for me. And she's like, he's fine, he's with Dad. And Holy Spirit basically told her, he is not fine. So she gets down on her knees and is just like pouring out her heart to the Lord. And this goes on for quite a while. And all of a sudden, it's not anymore. And she goes back about her day. And she was, from my perspective again, she was really interested in like what happened at Grandpa's. And I was like, everything was fine. We had a lot of fun. I don't want to be on the hook for paying for this four-wheeler. Like, I don't want, like, Grandpa will probably cover for me. And so I didn't say anything about it. And this went 2 days, 3 days. After a while, Grandpa came up and out. It came out in conversation that his four-wheeler was broken, and Mom asked more about that, and it came all the way back around to me. Turns out, I should have flown off that four-wheeler. I did hit a tree. And things that are going 50, 40, 30 miles an hour, when they hit a tree, they fly off. And I wasn't wearing a helmet. That could have been the end of my story. My mom didn't know the why. She just knew to pray. And she was faithful to it. And one of the things that I think about is that story when somebody comes to my mind and I didn't have a reason to think about them, and they just come to my mind. I pray for them regardless because I have no idea what's going on. Even if it's a breath prayer, God, I don't know what's going on with whoever it is, but I need you to be with them right now. They need to know that you're real. They need you to show up in a real way, whatever it is. But being faithful in the small things without knowing the end, you never know. So for some of you, it might be, I need to tell you this. I need to give you this. I need to bless you in this way. And you might not know, and it might not be a big deal. It might be. He might ask you to give you every last dollar in your wallet to somebody, and you might not know why. But he knows the reason he's asking you to be faithful. Our job is to remain faithful. Because the righteous will live by their faithfulness to God. And when you're faithful in a few things, God will trust you with much, much more. Don't underestimate a lifestyle of faithfulness over time. But when I look back at the Hall of Faith in Hebrews, and it's listing off all the people that were faithful over time, it isn't about the great things that they did. It is about the fact that they trusted God with the end, and they just did what was in front of them. Noah built the boat over decades. Moses took his staff and walked into the hall of Pharaoh without seeing any results the first 10, 12 times, whatever it was. Are you faithful with what is in front of you? It can be a relationship. It can be a resource. It can be a responsibility, but it is going to be specific. Take what's in your hand, and the obedience is on you. The outcome is on him. All right? You are not responsible for the outcome. You are responsible for your obedience. Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful in the few things, and I've made it many things. And that way, I don't get the credit. He does. It's for his glory. And for some of you, you made a good decision back there. But I'm here to remind you today, the fruit of that decision is not back there. It's still ahead of you. And it's faithfulness that is between your good decision and the end point. That's what's between you and the end point. It's not a mountain. It's faithfulness to God. He'll move the mountain. The faithfulness is what's between you and the end. So make your good decision, whatever that was. For me, whoever finds a wife finds a good thing. She's my good thing. I made a good decision. But the faithfulness is in the journey and it's at the end. A lifetime of faithfulness lived out in front of my kids and the people behind me. God, help me to be faithful. Thank you for what you've placed in my hand. Your gifts are unending. You are a good father. You give good gifts to your people. Help us to be responsible with what you've placed in our hands. Help us to settle it. Those good decisions that we made, may we just see the fruit of those all over this house. May we be faithful in the simple acts of kindness, in the simple prayers, in showing up for the people that you've put right in front of us. God, help us not to seek influence and trade favors and do it for the honor and glory of other people, but to do it for you. God, your people love you. It is the position of our hearts. And we say whatever you want to do, through whoever you want to do it through, however you want to do it today. Do it in me. Do it in my family. Your way. Because God, we trust you. We trust you with the outcome. You're worth investing in. You're worth our temporary stuff. Because you can make an eternal difference with it. So God, as we go from this place, I pray that we would work not as unto man, but unto you. That we would co-labor with you. That we would get your results from our everyday tasks by being faithful to you. Not by trying to be big, but by trying to put you first in every single thing. So God, as we sing and as we end and as we close, these are some tender times. There's some things that you've been specific with in this house and that you've asked your people to do. There's been some good decisions laid down, and we're begging you for the fruit of those decisions. Be faithful to us, God. We know we're not the faithful ones, but we know you are, and it's a fruit of your Spirit. So, Holy Spirit, have your way with whatever we bring. Take our sticks and help them to part the seas that are in front of us. So we take those few things and we pray that you would do the rest. We thank you, God, for what you're doing in this house, what you plan to do with everyone that surrenders themselves to you. We pray that you would make a huge difference in this place and moving forward. We do all this for your honor, for your glory.